Mr. Lindsay, you must have been asked my first question 100 times since you've been in England, but I must ask it. What is going to happen to your president?
I wish I knew. I've been away since January, so that I really am out of touch. Until today, I would have guessed that he'd stick it out for the balance of his term. I don't think he would ever resign, I'm guessing. I would be surprised if the Senate could collect a 2/3 vote to convict on a bill of impeachment, although I think it's entirely possible that the House of Representatives would vote out such a bill. I'm shaken by today's news because I think it had the opposite effect of what the president intended it to. And so that troubles me, and I'm not so sure at the moment as to whether or not he can stick it out until the end of his term.
Why shaken?
Well, it's a unprecedented thing for the U.S. except for one period of time shortly after the Civil War. It's depressing. Representative government is at stake. The venality of Watergate in our country is the worst form of abuse in a free democratic system, because what it is, it's the use of vast governmental powers, including police powers and that of regulatory agencies, for political ends. Now that's tough stuff. That is the use of police, and it drags down everything. And you may have noticed that if you believe in polls, which I don't much do, but if you believe in the Gallup and other polls in the United States, you'll see, for example, that the Congress is maybe at the lowest ebb in modern history in public opinion. So it's rubbed off on our parliament as well.
On politicians in general.
Yeah, on politicians in general, too.
But what is it about, I mean, the latest events? Because it seemed to me that this was just one more move on his behalf, as it were, to hold back the tide, to once again act like Canute and hold back the tide.
I think the reason that I'm shaken on it is that it was, first of all, it was advertised as something that would be exonerative. And it was not that. And in fact, it was a confirmation of knowledge by the president of a lot of things that were in doubt as to whether or not the president really knew about it or not. It's come to that kind of sliver issue. Admittedly, it's very difficult for Britons to understand it all. And I've just come from the continent, and heavens knows nobody understands it on the continent. Not a soul. It really is beyond everybody. And no European non-English speaking, no, which makes it more difficult to understand it even. No European can possibly imagine that an American president could be unseated over a thing like Watergate.
But can he, I mean, what does he himself think? I mean, it seems to me every time I look at him on television, he looks a little more grey, a little more hangdog. Yet there he is. Does he think he can get away with it?
That I don't know. Again, that's why I said that one has to only guess. I'm still guessing that the president would never resign. That's his history. It's unlike your system, of course. And I'm not sure he should at this moment. I think our processes, which are spelled out roughly in the Constitution, have triggered off now a process which probably ought to see its course. And at this point, to do what would happen in most parliamentary systems, where the head of government says, well, the people have lost confidence, that's that. That doesn't happen in our system. Our system is so different, it's hard to compare them.
Have the people lost confidence? Have you lost confidence?
Well, I was never for it. I was at one point. I supported President Nixon in 1968. And I became disillusioned with much, including so much of the Republican Party and the president's cabinet and everything else, that disappeared. And I finally left the Republican Party about 3 years ago, and never have regretted it for a moment either. But I think that I want to compliment the United States by saying that agonizing as the process is that the country is going through, I think it's to the credit of our system that it can do it and air its difficulties in this fashion.
But what's it doing to the United States? What's it doing to public life?
Depressing. It's very depressing at the moment. And I think people are discouraged about it. Some people are fed up with it, and they wish the country would get on to other things, and they would like to see it resolved. if the president has to get out, so be it. But they would like to see it resolved. But I think it's had a very depressing effect. I'm troubled that it may have the impact of discouraging a lot of people from politics and public life. We could even have a lost generation of young people who don't go in it. And if there's one thing that's needed throughout the Western world at the moment, I think it's high quality leadership. We have too much mediocrity almost everywhere, and that can be very discouraging.
Yeah, this is the amazing thing, that he appears to be able to carry on being a world leader and going to Moscow and taking part in the world forums and making a bit of peace here, a little bit of peace there, and those things to his credit, while at the same time being involved in this awful sort of squalid mess.
Well, you know, see, domestic politics is much more difficult than international politics, in my humble opinion. And it is true that heads of state throughout history have used the processes of foreign policy and international relations to buoy themselves at home. But I do think that life has gotten so complicated in most areas that that the domestic problem and the straightening out of one's own backyard, the creation of a high quality of life at home, the safeguarding of the environment, and making it possible for somebody to get to work and back again without getting run over by a taxi cab or by a car or meeting violence of some kind, has become so difficult that that heads of state seem to ignore it. I have the impression that countries all over the world, and I think this is true of the United States, have been turning inward. And the reason they have been is that things have gotten very complicated at home. And it does...
Well, turning inward while turning outward.
Turning inward in the sense that they're more concerned about what's happening in at home than they are anywhere else. And, of course, a country's foreign policy is only so strong as its quality is at home. And... I'm a great admirer of Mr. Kissinger's, and I think he's doing a first-class job. On the other hand, no one can really say that he represents fundamental principles of freedom and justice. What he's doing is patching things up and skillfully using a lot of scotch tape, and may run out of luck on that. But what is important for the United States is that it hold out an ideal of freedom and justice for every single person and every American. And that is not in people's minds today.
Can you take the role of a man like Dr. Kissinger, who goes around the world as the apostle of the free society and tries, as you say, to patch things up and to make peace? What do you think he feels about the president and the man he works for, as it were, the chief executive?
How does one know? I'm sure that it's a complicating factor in the in his job. But the trouble is that Dr. Kissinger is practicing 19th century international politics, which is power politics, and balance of power is what it all amounts to, which is good so long as it works. The trouble is that the world has gotten so crowded and so complicated that it's very important for some free countries, most especially, I think, our two countries, to always be in the position of standing for some social ideal on the human condition. And in the present politics of the United States, it's very hard for anybody to have that kind of vision about the country.
It was a British politician who stood up and said to Chamberlain, I think in 1940, when it was time for him to go, in the name of God, go. Isn't it time that somebody said that to your president?
Again, that has been said, I've found over the years, I was a member of the U.S. Congress for 7 years, and I found all that period of time and since, that one of the most frustrating exercises that you can engage in is trying to compare parliamentary systems like yours and ours. They are so different. I would think that the only way by which the president could be persuaded to resign voluntarily, which again I would guess will not happen, the only way it could happen is if the leadership of the Republican Party, which is conservatively oriented, and Mr. Nixon's conservative base in the Congress, came to him and said, said, this is genuinely the end of the party unless you step aside and let Mr. Ford take over.
And no sign of that.
And there's no immediate sign of that. And even if that did happen, I'm still not sure that it would have an impact.
Mr. Lindsay, thank you very much indeed.